What's happening, y'all? In this video, we're at a milestone. We're about to learn how to define matrices in MATLAB. Remember, the word MATLAB stands for matrix laboratory. I would claim that the source of MATLAB and the reason that it exists in this world is because of the functionality that it brings into matrix calculations. MATLAB, in the original form, was a matrix calculator. The reason the engineers really love it is matrices happen to be a cornerstone of good mathematical modeling in the real world. This video represents our use of MATLAB to define matrices as variables. How exciting. Let's jump right in. We'll formally define what a matrix is. We're going to call this an entry by entry definition of an M by N matrix. M as in Monday, N as in November. So M will represent the number of rows. N will represent the number of columns. Here we'll start by saying that M and N are natural numbers, so positive whole numbers. We say that an M by N matrix A is a rectangular array of real numbers with M rows and N columns. We define that as A equals this matrix. We're going to delimit the outside with square braces. And then we're going to define either row by row or column by column by actually writing each individual entry. In this case, we'll go row by row. Row one, the first entry of row one is A11. Then we move on to the next one, A12. And we continue to go all the way to the last entry of that row, which is A1n. We move down to the next row in that matrix in column one of row two. This is A21. Then A22, all the way down to the last entry, which is A2n. And then we can keep going down in the rows until we get to the last row of our matrix. In this case, we've claimed that our matrix has M rows, so the last row is row number M. Here, the first entry of that row is AM1, AM2, all the way to the last column, which is AMn, since this matrix is said to have N columns. The reason we call this the entry by entry definition of our matrix A is we are defining this matrix by physically writing every single entry in this matrix. Each of those entries is a single scalar or real number, and they're known as either entries, elements, or coefficients of our matrix. Now that we have that formal mathematics definition in hand, let's look at how we actually define such a matrix using MATLAB syntax. Here we see that to define our matrix, we're going to use the assignment operator in MATLAB. On the left-hand side, we're going to have the name of our matrix, just like any variable name that we've seen in the past. Then we're going to say equals using the assignment operator. Immediately, we open with the left brace, and then, of course, close with the right brace. To define the individual entries, we're going to follow the same habit that we did with row vectors. A11 will be our first entry, comma, A12, comma, all the way to the last entry of row one. When we're done with row one, we'll put a semicolon. Then we'll go on to row two. We'll put each individual entry in the second row. There are n of them because we said that there were n columns in this matrix. When we're done with that, we put a semicolon. We type all the individual entries of every single row in our matrix, ending each row with a semicolon. Until we get to the last row of our matrix, we type those entries. And of course, we end with a square brace. Now that we have that, let's suppose that we're going to define the matrix we see on screen here, which is a 3x3 matrix. It has 1, 2, 3 rows and 1, 2, 3 columns. That matrix has the entries 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's go ahead and use our definition. So in this case, we're going to say A equals 1, 2, 3, semicolon. We're going to go down to the next row, which is 4, 5, 6, semicolon. Then we'll go down to the last row, which is 7, 8, 9, end with a close brace and push enter. Notice that gives me the entire matrix that I wanted, and we called this a entry by entry definition because I physically had to type out all the entries. I want to make two comments to show you some additional syntax. Remember that we said that when we're defining the rows of a matrix, we can delimit each column by a space. So I could have equally defined 1, 2, 3. When I'm going down columns, I can just use carriage return, or if I hit enter, the same thing works. 4, 5, 6, enter, 7, 8, 9, and then close this with a square bracket on the right-hand side and push enter. I get the same matrix out. In other words, just like the space allows me to do the same thing as the comma, so too does the carriage return or hitting enter allow me to do the same thing as the semicolon. I would invite you viewers to notice the difference between the two of these. Notice in the first call, the comma clearly indicates where one ends and the second one begins. It tells me where the first column is versus the second column. And then the semicolons are really, really helpful for figuring out where the individual rows happen. The reason that this is useful is I can actually define my entire matrix just on the same line. So specifically, notice 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. When I've used this notation, I can really, really see, oh, okay, so this is the first row, second entry, because I can see there's the semicolon, there's the entry. When I push enter, notice that matrix happens here. Compare that where I'm using the commas and the semicolons to not using the commas. Notice the commas allow me to count entries really, really quickly, where here I actually have to physically do that, right? Because I'm using spaces in that situation. So the recommendation that I have is always use commas and semicolons, even if you're using return. The other thing that I want to show you is when I'm defining a matrix entry by entry, and I say 1, 2, 3, and then I go down to the next one, notice that I can't actually hit the return if I've already closed the left bracket. To get around this, what I can do is to use a carriage return, which is to shift enter, and that will get me down to the next case. Then I can go 1, 2, 3, then go down to the next one by using shift enter in my case, 4, 5, 6, shift enter, 7, 8, 9, and then I'll close this out with a semicolon to suppress that. So the point is that semicolons delimit every individual row, and then commas delimit the corresponding columns of our matrix. For the matrix A given on screen here, I wanted to show you a fun use of colon notation. Notice we could actually define A using what we call a row partition. So specifically, the first row starts at 1, goes up by 1, and stops at 3. If I enter the semicolon, that tells me that's the end of that row. The second row starts at 4, goes up by 1, and goes to 6, semicolon, end of the second row. And the third row starts at 7, goes up by 1, and ends at 9. Notice this is no longer the entry by entry definition of our matrix. Instead, it is a row by row definition. We can also call that a row partition. We can do the same thing. Let's suppose that I wanted to go a 5 by 5 matrix, which counts from 1 to 25. So start at 1, go up by 1, end at 5, that's row 1. Row 2 would start at 6, go up by 1, end at 10, end that row, which is semicolon. The third row would start at 11, go up by 1, and go to 15. The fourth row would start at 16, go up by 1, end at 20. And of course, the last row of this matrix would start at 21, go up by 1, and end at 25. That is now a 5 by 5 matrix that captures much of the data that I wanted to. Of course, for you as two viewers at home, you probably realize that I could have done the same definition, produced the same matrix, without specifying the increment size. Remember, the default increment size for colon notation is 1. So this shorter command actually produces the same matrix as my larger command. I just don't specify all the increment sizes in between because the default for colon notation is 1. In later videos in our sequence, we're going to call this a row partition definition of C, not an entry by entry definition, but a block row partition, because we are not defining C entry by entry, we're defining C row by row. There will be a similar example called a column partition version. That is a coming attraction. What I wanted to draw your attention to now is something called block partitioning of a matrix. Over here on the screen, you see a matrix that arises in electrical engineering application related to testing circuits. We're going to see these in other videos in our MATLAB work together, because I believe that one of the best ways to teach you MATLAB is to help you use it to solve real-world problems. The point of this, though, is that the entry-by-entry definition of this matrix A sub G is quite tedious. Moreover, this matrix is what we call block partition. So in order to form this matrix, we're going to form 3 submatrices, A sub RG, a sub vg, and a sub ig. That's exactly what I've done here. I've taken that first block over on screen and turned it into a variable declaration. Here I've just used spaces and carriage returns or shift enters to get my matrix in the form that I wanted. I have not used commas because I specifically used spaces to make this look really beautiful. And it's actually quite easy to see where column one is, where column two is, column three, column four. Try this at home and see how long this actually takes. I'm gonna go ahead and push enter on this. Once I've done so, I now have A sub RG stored in memory. Look, MATLAB is producing exactly as I expected. Let's go ahead and clear my screen. After clearing my screen, I can also store A sub VG using spaces appropriately so that the columns all line up and it's super easy to see. Notice on screen over here is my definition, and that's exactly what I'm storing in MATLAB here. I'll go ahead and push enter. Now A sub VG is also stored in memory. Notice the last subblock of this matrix that I'm trying to define is A sub IG, and it looks like this over here. It looks like two rows and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 columns. Here I've defined those exact entries on screen and I push enter. That will store it in memory. We can now go over to the workspace and confirm that A sub RG is an 8-row by 7 column matrix, or an 8 by 7. A sub VG is a 2 by 7, so it has 2 rows and 7 columns, and A sub IG has 2 rows and 7 columns. The claim that we're making here in this definition on screen is if I wanted to form the larger matrix A sub G, I can just stack the sub matrices A sub RG on top of A sub VG on top of A sub IG. And in fact, that's exactly what I'm going to do in MATLAB here. Notice A sub G is equal to A sub RG. Then I delimit the rows because I'm going to take 8 rows and then put below those 8 rows, 2 more rows. So I put a semicolon because this is by rows. Then I'm going to put the matrix A sub VG. Then I'm going to put the matrix A sub IG. Check this out. When I enter this command, this large matrix is identical to the matrix that you see on screen, except I've done it by block partitioning. So defining individual blocks of that matrix. Let's take a look at a different example. Here we'll define an incidence matrix for a directed graph, which we'll talk about in a different video. But we're gonna take, in this case, we go 0, 1, 0 in the first row. The second row is -1, 1. And the third row is 0, -1. When I push enter, notice this matrix on screen is stored as A on my computer. Last comment I'm going to make about defining matrices is when we're defining matrices row by row, we need to make sure that each row has the same number of entries. Let's suppose that I do a 2-row, 3-column matrix in the first row. So this is 1, 2, 3. But then in the second row, I only put 2 columns. Watch this. MATLAB gets mad at me because the second row doesn't have the same number of entries as the first row, which means I'm trying to kind of append on the bottom of a 1 by 3 vector, a 1 by 2 vector. Those are different dimensions. MATLAB does not work well with that. Instead, every time I define a row as part of a matrix, row 1 has to have the same number of entries of row 2, the same number of entries as row 3, etc., 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 so that the dimensions work out. Indeed, when I execute that, we see MATLAB produces a matrix because row 1 has the same numbers as row 2. This leads me to the last comments I'm going to make in this video. MATLAB stores all numeric data as arrays. This is why we call it an array-based programming language. Every number that we store is going to be stored as an array. So a scalar is a 1 by 1 matrix. A row vector is a 1 by n matrix. A column vector is an m by 1 matrix. An m by n matrix just has m rows and n columns. Any numeric variable that I store in MATLAB will be stored as an array. We also talked about something called an array. There's something called a one-dimensional array, which is just a vector in math terms. Two-dimensional arrays are called matrices in math because we're not limited to either having one column or one row. Matrices, you can have multiple rows and multiple columns. Remember, all vectors are matrices, but not all matrices are vectors. Another feature that's kind of noteworthy is we don't have to define the dimensions of the array before we give its entry by entry definition. The dimensions are implicit as we define that, and we saw examples of that in this video. In later videos, we're gonna see how we can manipulate entries of a matrix on the fly. We can do a lot of stuff to actually change the structure of a matrix after we've already defined it. The last thing that I'll say is I tend to reserve single capital letters for defining matrices and single lowercase letters to defining either scalars or vectors, and then I can check the size, which we'll see in a bit. This follows our tradition in mathematics where we leave uppercase letters for matrices and lowercase letters for either vectors or scalars. To end this video, I'm going to pose a $1 million community challenge. Quite literally, if you solve this challenge well, you could make $1 million for yourself. In the comments section to this video, please link to interesting resources that teach how to construct matrices from real-world examples. If I was leaving an answer to this comment, I would actually post to a website that I've created. We're going to do this in my MATLAB class. One of the gifts that I hope to give my viewers is insights into how mathematics shows up in real-world modeling. Recently, I constructed a novel algorithm. I've never seen any other mathematician on Earth work with this algorithm that allows us to transform this circuit that you see on screen into this matrix on the left-hand side, and then eventually do some mathematics on the matrix on the left-hand side to turn it into something called a non-singular linear system. This shows up in linear algebra. But my answer to this question actually is we can transform electric circuits into matrices using particular rules. I actually document a lot more about that in my laboratory experiment section of my website. So if you go to appliedlinearalgebra.com, then go to blogs for teachers, linear algebra exercises. Both these exercises, the make the eigenvalue problem resonate with our students and electrify the linear systems problem for our students, if you click on learn more on either of those, I have a bunch of resources that show my viewers and anybody that's interested how to turn real world modeling problems into matrix algebra that we can use MATLAB to analyze. For the community challenge, I would encourage you, if you know resources that teach viewers how to turn real world modeling into matrices, post those links in this video. To be completely honest with you, the ability to turn real world stuff into matrices actually made MATLAB a necessity, and it's the reason that that's a money-making company. MATLAB provides working engineers a fast platform to do calculation with matrices. In fact, it is a computer language designed to do math on matrices. I would claim that the reason that it's valuable is that there have been whole generations of mathematicians and engineers who have learned to turn applied modeling problems into matrices and then use MATLAB to analyze those matrices and produce some interesting results. We're going to get practice with that together, but in today's community challenge, I would like to reach out to you bright and hardworking community members to see if you can get your brains moving on that problem. That ends this video on how to define matrices in MATLAB. We're going to see how to use elementary matrix functions in a future video to also define special matrices. I'll see you there.